It's good to be together this morning. Welcome to worship at River Park Church. A special welcome to our guests and our visitors who are with us, also those worshiping on Zoom and who are watching or listening to our recording at a later date. I'm Adrian de Lange. I'm one of the pastors here at River Park. And before we begin, I want to share just a few announcements with you about our service today and a few things going on. So after our service, the youth group are going to meet. They've got some games and some food planned, so that's going to be a wonderful time for them. And during our service today, we will dismiss kids up to grade 5 for Sunday school and Jacob's Ladder. And we're also going to celebrate communion. And so if you had an opportunity before the service to grab one of these little cups with a wafer on top, just hold on to that. If you haven't had a chance to grab one, I invite you to do that. In our tradition, communion is for everyone who's a part of the family of God. And so if everyone who has a faith in Jesus is invited to participate and come to the table of the Lord. Also, as we begin, I just want to remind you that behind me, there's a QR code that you can scan if you want to see our order of service and know the kind of pieces and parts that are coming and the movements that we're going to move through in the next hour or so. One more note before we begin, which is that our special offering later in the service is for Emma House. We'll have an opportunity later in the service to give both to the work and ministry of River Park Church and to Emma House, whose mission is to provide safe, supportive transitional housing program for expectant mothers age 12 plus who are homeless or at risk of homelessness. So if you're able, I want to invite you to stand at this time for our call to worship and our opening song. So please stand. David in Psalm 122 says, "I rejoiced with those who said to me, 'Let us go to the house of the Lord.'" What a joy it is to be gathered together in this place this morning, but to be welcomed, not into this building, but into the household of God and the family of God. That's the joy of gathering together as God's people. That's a joy that begins our service.
Let's bow our heads in a short prayer as we begin our worship time. Lord, you are our light, and we don't want to hide you under the bushel that might be our personal anxieties, our personal problems. Lord, maybe even use those problems to help us shine your light in this world. Lord, we stand on your mountain of love that we celebrate with this song, and we pray that that joy will come out of us today. Amen.
Is amazing, steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain firm beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you gently lift me when I am surrounded. Your love carries me.
Makes me see. Your love is surprising.
As we head into this next song, I want you to take some time to greet one another. I want you to say, find somebody you don't know, or maybe someone you haven't had over for coffee for a while, and maybe invite them over. You know, my parents had this great tradition, and I honestly have never done it. So it's not like I'm telling you to do something that I do all the time. I'm going to tell you, I'm going to ask you to do something that is a really powerful tool. I know there's at least a few couples in this church that are here, because the first Sunday my parents saw you in church, they invited you over for coffee. And, you know, it doesn't have to be like a coffee necessarily at your house. Maybe your house is a mess. Take them out for a coffee sometime. I just think that that's such a beautiful thing to do, to get to know one another. So greet one another, maybe find someone you haven't had over for coffee for a while, or something meaningful, because some people say we shouldn't have greeting time because it's not meaningful. We'll make it meaningful. Take some time. Greet somebody. Say hi. Remind them of your name. Join us for singing when you're ready. I don't want to interrupt you, but we're going to start singing.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait. You won't rule, we'll reign.
is our last song now before the kids. I'm so glad some of you have come up with Get Flags. This is the last song for the kids to participate in worship. I hope that more will come join us in this last song. And after this song, the kids are dismissed to go to their Sunday school or go to Jacob's Ladder, as the case may be. But I want to read a brief verse from Ephesians 1, verse 3. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. Let's sing Blessed Be Your Name, our third song. And, we bless His name whether we're suffering or whether we're not. In fact, sometimes I found in my experience it's through the suffering that I bless His name even more. Because so often I find when I'm being blessed with like earthly blessings like wealth and a beautiful family, I just take it for granted. I just stop trusting God, honestly. And God wakes you up. God woke me up. So let's really focus on God. Whether maybe sometimes the more blessed we are right now, the more we need to focus on God. Because when I was in my suffering times, it wasn't hard.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in a desert place. Though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Blessed be your name. Your hands hanging down on me.
Say a word of blessing on you kids now as you head off to Sunday school and Jacob's Ladder. Lord, bless the teachers, bless the lessons, bless the time of fellowship and talking for these kids. That way truly be a time when they feel loved, when they feel connected to you, and when they get to understand what it really means to love you as their God and Savior. Amen. And while the kids are going, I still want you to stand. We're going to sing a much different song now. We're going to sing about suffering, really. And I found this song one of those that I couldn't stop crying during. It was really tough for me to worship lead during those years when I was going through my darkest, deepest times. And I have to say that this song was so reassuring that I had to hang on to God's commands. I needed to hang on to God tighter than ever when I was going through that tough time. You know, God's first command is to love Him, and His second is to love one another, and I couldn't give up that. I had to keep that going because that's all I had left. And so let's empathize with those around us who are suffering today. Let's help them feel that love that God wants us to share with one another and that God gives us through His Word, through His Holy Spirit, and through things that are far beyond our understanding.
Surrender now, I give you everything. You're good.
of the goodness of God.
Please be seated.
Join me as we pray. Creator and Redeemer, Lord of springtime, winter, and all seasons of this world and our lives, we come to you today, O Lord. Blessed be your name. Lord, we thank you for the turning of spring as your world comes to life. Brown turns to green. Tulips spring from the earth. Birdsong rings in our ears. Help us shout your praises as well, O Lord, as we think of all your blessings in our lives. Jesus, you are good. You are merciful. Lord, you are faithful to us and our ever solid rock. Today and all days, help us to reach out and anchor into your never-ending love. Lord, we pray for life and for love for those in our church body who are hurting, Lord, those who need a special measure of care. Help us to sense those among us who need your breath and touch that we can reach out to this week. Great healer, we lift up our sisters and brothers who need you in special ways. We pray for those who are battling with age, with physical illness, with anxiety and other illnesses in our minds, Lord. Jesus, show your love to your servants this week, today. Use us to be your arms and voice in this world for those who need you and your touch and care this week. Almighty Lord, Prince of Peace, we pray for this world. God, we know that you know and see all of the strife and pain and conflict around the globe. Jesus, we don't know what your plan is. We pray for peace. We pray for swift resolution to conflict in the Ukraine and other areas of the globe where men are following the desires of their hearts instead of your desires, O Lord. Spirit, we pray for River Park Church. We pray for your church here as we continue to move through transition periods, through on-ramps and off-ramps in our lives. Lord, bring forth leaders to support our church and all of our ministry. Church ministry, children ministry leaders, deacons, elder, coffee hosts, sound team, all in between, Lord. Thank you for River Park and those who serve your church here. We thank you for the blessing that River Park is to each of us. Thank you for bringing our visitors here this morning. Help us to grow and share your love with all around us as we reach out to those among us and continue to build your wonderful mosaic community here on earth, Lord. Lord, bless Pastor Adrian's words this morning. Thank you for providing him your message to us this week. Speak to our souls and minds through Pastor Adrian this morning. Beautiful One, Almighty Lord, Savior of the world, hear our prayer. Amen.
And this is the time in the service we're going to receive our offerings, and I want to talk a little bit about that. Like, this is a really wonderful time to worship. It's a physical expression, just like song and just like prayers are, a physical expression of our love for God, giving of our plenty. And of course, God expects much from people who've been blessed much. And I think sometimes that's why we turn away from God when he blesses us so richly. It's because we don't want to admit how much we owe him. And these offerings, just so you know how it works, first of all, we don't want anybody to feel obligated to give. We give out of the goodness God has given us. And especially if someone's new here, I don't want you to feel that this is really part of the service that you need to be part of, because this is a family thing. And what we do here as a family is we bring our offerings forward. It's a wonderful demonstration of our love. And these two baskets, the blue one is for the ministries of our church here, and the smaller plate is for Emma House, which, as was already mentioned, is helping young women who are pregnant and at risk of living on the streets, to help them keep their babies, help them take care of their babies, help them learn mothering skills when they are left without the support that a father and husband could give them. So that's how we're going to receive our offerings. And we'll start by singing during the song, sitting, and then I'll get you to stand as people have come forward.
When Jesus was doing his ministry, Matthew's gospel tells us that at one point people brought little children to Jesus for him to place his hands on them and pray for them and bless them, but the disciples rebuked them. Jesus said to them, "Let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of heaven The kingdom of God belongs to such as these. We see in our kids coming forward to wave flags what it is that the kingdom of God belongs to children. Children want to be a part of the family and a part of the story and are eager to bring themselves to do that. Kids are quick to go all in. And this morning, we continue our all-in series, looking at God's all-in love for his people, sending Jesus as the way, the truth, and the life for us. And if that were not enough, also sending us his Holy Spirit to empower us to follow the way of Jesus, to believe and trust the truth of Jesus, and to live the life of the body of Christ. Well, many of us are schooled in the truth of Jesus, and some of us have studied the life of Jesus. I think few of us really have experienced the way of Jesus as a model to follow, as a way that we can align our lives and have our lives transformed. Yet this is exactly what Jesus and his ministry intended. So this morning, I've entitled our sermon, Separation and Intimacy, because I want to focus on those two things. Separation as our current reality, the state of affairs in our broken world, and intimacy as both God's creational good intent and also the future and even the present that he holds out for us. So as we open up God's word this morning, we're going to read Ephesians chapter 2. And I just invite you to listen to the words and to wonder if you can see those two categories at play, separation and intimacy. This is what the Apostle Paul says, writing to the church in Ephesus. Therefore, remember that formerly you who are Gentiles by birth and called, quote, uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, which is done in the body by human hands, remember that at that time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel and foreigners to the covenant of promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who were once far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one, who has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by setting aside in his flesh the law with its commandments and regulations. His purpose was to create in himself one new humanity out of the two, thus making peace, and by or in one body to reconcile both of them, both parties or both sides, to God through the cross, by which he put to death their hostility. He came and preached peace to you who were far away, and also peace to you who were near. For through him we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. Consequently, as a result, you're no longer foreigners or strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people, and also members of God's household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Jesus himself as the cornerstone, the chief cornerstone. In him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. So far, the reading of God's word. As we look at separation and intimacy, I want to add just one more thing into the mix here. It's a short video by Leonard Cohen, who's a prolific songwriter and singer, and he sings about intimacy in his song, Anthem. Leonard Cohen is also a prolific mumbler, and so you may not be able to understand the first few seconds of the video, but the actual lyrics are subtitled. So let's watch that together.
Thank you so much, friends. We're so privileged to be able to gather in moments like this when so much of the world is plunged in darkness and chaos. So, ring the bells that still can ring. Forget your perfect offering. There is a crack in everything. That's how the light gets in.
There is a crack in everything. That's how the light gets in. Leonard Cohen suggests that there's a crack in everything, that everything is broken in some way. Even us as people, we're broken. Not just individually, but interpersonally as well. That the parts and pieces of us are separate from one another, and they are the things that, the brokenness is what separates us from one another. I'm not sure I really have to convince you that this is true. After the past 2 years, I hardly need to describe separation, it feels like. All of us have gotten used to physical distancing. We've gotten used to self-isolating. We know what it is to meet online and have days where we don't leave our house. But these are physical separation. And of course, there's more to it than that. But I wonder whether the greatest pain of separation is being in a room filled with people and yet still feeling completely alone. There's a kind of separation that's deeper than just physical separation. It's an acute disconnection from meaningful relationship with other people and with God. And that separation is not new. It's not something that started 2 years ago. It's been there since the beginning. There is a crack in everything. This kind of separation has faced humanity since our fall into sin. The acute pain of separation fades into a dull ache so that most of us can survive with it. And yet it's there. It manifests as loneliness or depressive thoughts, even social anxiety. The idea that we get used to being separate, we get used to having parts and pieces of us missing, and we're not sure we know how to interact with others. And what's more, we don't just want a sort of surface level contact. We long for intimacy, for something more, something deeper. Which is not to say that surface level conversation is bad, but it is to say that if in the family of God, all we have is just surface level conversation, that's part of the brokenness and the cracks and everything as well. I don't believe that separation is first about being physically isolated. Separation is first about shame. Shame is a couple things. One is shame is our internal emotional feeling about ourselves. Sadness because I don't feel worthy of others' love. Hurt because I am an afterthought. Awkwardness, because I feel I don't belong. But shame is also about our external behavior in relation to the rest of the group or the group in relation to us. That I'm not welcome in the group. That others avoid me. That no one will listen to me or help me or attend to me. Because we all live in a sinful world, we all experience shame and sin. People from different cultures may experience it differently. And yet there it is, for all of us, a part of sin's curse. There is a crack in everything. I was sitting with a friend over the weekend talking about this brokenness, how everything in our world is broken and affected by sin. And in the context of that conversation, he asked me about the Bible. He said, well, if everything is broken, what about the Bible? After all, he reasoned, it's written by people. People are selfish. People lie. There's a crack in everything. I responded to him that as people, we all have to put our faith in something or someone. Many of us put our faith in ourselves. We're the ones who have to decide what's true and what's false, who to trust and who to distrust. But Christians, we put our faith in God. We trust that God's way is better than our way. We trust that His Word, the Word made flesh, is the way, the truth, and the life. And Christians follow the way of Jesus, not because we understand it, but because we believe the truth of Jesus, and we desire to live the life of the body of Christ, At least we're supposed to. That's how it's supposed to be. But there is a crack in everything. There is always a gap, isn't there, between who we are, really, and who we are supposed to be. The story of the Bible begins with God's, or our good God, in perfect community, creating human beings in his image to invite them into intimacy with him. He makes Eve out of Adam's body, which is not an emphasis about who's first and who's last, but of physical oneness, of intimacy. Intimacy is a part of the created order, part of God's intent and part of what he put in us from the beginning. But Adam and Eve are removed from the garden because they try to make a name for themselves apart from relationship with God. Adam and Eve experience the shame of separation from God and from one another. I'm going back and retelling a little bit of the story of Scripture because it's important for us to remember that these things are connected. That the further we are from God, the further we are from one another as well. I have an image to try and help us process or understand this. So you see behind me that ball with all of these little points on it. Just imagine as an individual that you're one of those little red things on the end, and that the community you're a part of makes up the other pieces. Now watch what happens when you try to pull just one piece apart from all the other ones. Everything pulls apart. If we try to pull away from God, we pull away from everyone else as well. When we withdraw from just one other person, we withdraw from the entire community. God created us as interconnected people, built for intimacy with one another, built for intimacy with God. And the story of the Bible begins in the garden and ends in a city, but it begins with intimacy and it ends with intimacy. But it's interrupted by that separation, by the crack in everything. So what connects the intimacy at the beginning of the story to the intimacy at the end? Well, it's a tree with a builder nailed to it. Adam and Eve were sent away from the tree in the garden. But Jesus was irrevocably connected to the tree so that we could come near, so that we could access his life, so that we could access his peace. His purpose, Paul says, was to create in himself one new humanity out of the two, thus making peace. And in one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, by which he put to death their hostility. It's a tree in the old city of Jerusalem that connects the garden in the beginning of the story to the city at the end. It's the tree in the city that Paul is talking about when he says, "You have been brought near by the blood of Christ." Being brought near is not about substitutionary atonement. Being brought near is about covering our shame. When Jesus says, my God, why have you forsaken me?" It's the moment when we can be assured that God knows the pain and the shame that we know. The shame of being forsaken, of being rejected, of being second best. The shame of being isolated and ignored. Yet in the cross, we are no longer isolated, no longer separated, no longer left for ourselves to help ourselves. Being brought near is a picture of intimacy and a picture of connection. As we draw near to God, we are drawn near to one another as well. I want to explain all this in the context of the arc of the story of Scripture from the beginning in the garden to the end in the city, because this is the arc that Paul talks about when he talks about intimacy as being built as a household with Christ as the cornerstone. The implications of this language that Paul uses, that we are built into a house with Christ as the cornerstone, the implications of this are so staggering that we can't even go into all of them this morning. But I want to just touch on a few. First, That intimacy is related to our creational identity, as we already mentioned. Intimacy is not a value to pursue. It's not something nice that we should try to get around to. Intimacy allows us to recapture and re-experience our original value, our original worth. Intimacy is about being closer to God, but also being closer to one another. Intimacy in this is a gift, a great gift from God, not a task. Second, that God intends to cement us together. That's the image of the house that Paul is working with. That is, these bricks are staying there when you build a house. This also means that the shallow connection that many of us have in the church is, as I said, also a part of that crack in everything. If all we have is shallow connection and distant relationship, then we've got a pretty weak house. But God has made us for deep, committed connection, for deep relationships that will transform us in deep ways. Third, God is using cracked and broken people to build his house. Isn't it amazing? As I said, that Jesus on the cross knew our shame, knew our separation. God is not surprised by our brokenness. He's not surprised by your sin or by the things that cause other people to push you away. He knows what it is to be ignored, forsaken, and abandoned. And God uses cracked and broken people to build his house anyway. He knows our sin. He knows our brokenness. And yet it pleases him to shine through and to fill us all with himself and with his glory. This is how God covers our shame, how God restores our honor. He not only invites us to the table, which we will gather together in a minute, he puts us in significant positions. He connects us to one another and makes us into an interdependent and interconnected whole. Of all of the implications of this picture that Paul uses in Ephesians chapter 2, I want to just pursue this one, this last one, that Paul says that all of this is for our peace, for our peace. When the Bible talks about peace, it's not just talking about the absence of war. It's talking about flourishing for everyone and everything. When the Bible talks about peace, in other words, it's talking about intimacy. Intimacy is about flourishing for everyone within the context of the family of God, within the context of right and good relationship with God. That's what intimacy is all about. I think it's important to say and to remember that, to hold that picture of intimacy close to our hearts, peace and flourishing for everyone who's a part of the family of God, especially because our denomination this summer is going to look at a human sexuality report. And it's interesting to me that in the context of that report, that no one is arguing that humans are made for intimacy. We all agree on that. Intimacy makes us flourish. Intimacy with God, and intimacy with others. But sadly, we get ourselves tied in knots because all of us, and I'm going to be so bold as to say all of us, and so if I'm wrong, come find me after the service. But all of us, I think, whether we're conservative or liberal, whether we're immigrants or lifelong Canadians, whether we're young or old, all of us think wrongly that sexual intimacy is the best kind of intimacy. When in fact, sexual intimacy is just another of God's good gifts that point us ultimately to intimacy with him. Whether we're having sex or not having sex, everything in our world points us to say that sexual intimacy is the most important, the best kind. The scripture tells us that intimacy with God is the best kind. That intimacy with the family of God is the best kind. That in fact, the kingdom of heaven doesn't belong to married couples. The kingdom of heaven belongs to children. Why? Because they know what it is to run to the arms of a loving parent. They know what it is to be a part of a group and to welcome others, to wave flags with them. Over and over, Scripture tells us, if we have ears to hear, that even marriage points us to the intimacy between Christ and his church. It's that intimacy which we aim toward. That is how the light gets in. The word in Jesus' day for this kind of intimacy, this kind of family intimacy, was oikos. Oikos is not about Greek yogurt. That's just what Dannon wants you to think. They want you to have their Greek yogurt around the house. That's oikos means house. Not just the building, but it means house, household, and family. And as Greek verbs go, and you don't have to care about this, but it's also not just a noun, but a verb. And as a verb, it's about building. It's about deepening and growing. Because that's what you do, not just with a house, you build it, but with a family and with a household. You build it, you grow it, you strengthen it. And as I alluded to before, Jesus was a builder. We sometimes mistakenly think that Jesus was a carpenter, and as in a furniture builder, right? But Jesus' earthly father, Joseph, was actually a builder, not with wood, but with stones. Just like Peter's family business was fishing, like Matthew was a tax collector, Jesus' family business, his dad's business, his earthly father's business, was building. So even in a passage that I referenced a few months back, where Jesus says to Peter, "You are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church." Jesus is inviting Peter, he's inviting his disciples, and through Paul, inviting all of us to be a part of his father's business. Not his earthly father's business, building luxury condos. His heavenly father's business, building the family of God. What does building this intimacy look like? Well, intimacy is for people. And so it's not an optional add-on to a slate of programs that as a church we might offer. Intimacy is an integral part of what God intends the church to be. Let's just read these last few verses from Ephesians chapter 2 again. Verses that I've gone back through and you can see highlighted. As consequently, Paul says, you're no longer foreigners or strangers, but fellow citizens in the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. In him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a body, holy to the Lord. In him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling place where God lives by his Spirit. All those words in green are built on that oikos root in Greek. They're all about the house, the household, the family of God. But the family of God that also is not just a building, but is a body, holy to the Lord, Paul says. This is the payoff for Paul and for us today. That this is the purpose that everything else is building toward. Being all in doesn't mean that we all agree on everything. If we built a house based on our agreement, based on our own complete, incomplete understanding, if we built a house based on my way of doing things or your priorities, we would have a weak house indeed. Likewise, if the bricks are running off and doing their own thing without concern for the rest, we'll have a weak house. Being all in doesn't mean we agree on everything. It means we embrace our identity in God's family, that we are joined together with Jesus as we each do our part in his Father's business, building the family of God. How do we do that? How do we hold together the family of God? Well, we can use big words or we can use small words, one small word, but it's not too difficult. Jesus' message in Scripture is clear. If you want to talk about Christian theology, it starts with God is love. Christian worship starts with love God. Christian spirituality, love your neighbor as yourself. Christian community, love one another. And Christian ethics, love your enemies. These are not just my ideas or me trying to be clever. These are the things that Jesus taught in his ministry. Not just once, but repeatedly, again and again, in different contexts, to different groups of people. I can guess already that you're tempted to see these things, these beliefs, these values, these actions as the building block, that the church is built with love. But let me just remind you one final time today that you are the building blocks. That Paul says that you are the building blocks that Christ has chosen to build his church. It's love that is the glue and the mortar that holds the building together. But you and I, we are the bricks. We are what God is building to use his house, or what is God is using to build his house. The stone the builders rejected has become a cornerstone, Scripture says, and with him, with Christ as the cornerstone, all of us rise, all of us are built up. So as we close this morning, I want to offer you a challenge. Will you allow the love of God to connect you to others in his household? Will you take the time to allow the mortar of God's love to set? God has brought you near. He's brought us near. How will you remain near? How will you remain near to God and to God's people? If Jesus is our cornerstone, if he is our peace, if he has destroyed the barrier of hostility between us, then here's the challenge. Rather than trying to bring up another topic or another thing to talk about, which is always a temptation for people like me who are very task-oriented, what would it look like to find someone outside of your biological family, someone in the family of God whom you trust, and to just tell them something about yourself, something you're struggling with, something that is just true about you? Not to try to change them, not to try to look good or to help others, just to build intimacy together. Just to share some of your brokenness with them and see if the light of God can shine through. See what God will do. To see if he will not draw you and draw us closer together. I'm going to leave that last line up on the screen behind me and come to God in prayer. Father God, we're going to celebrate in just a moment that what we receive from you, we also pass on to others. That we received from you, your Son, made human. That he became the cornerstone of your new family, the new household of God. That it is marvelous in our sight. God, teach us what it is to embrace our humanity as well. To not try to be more or different than we are, but to rest in your love, and to find intimacy in your community, so that we might be built up together into the kind of house that you desire, the house that you design with you as the cornerstone, you are foundation that everything else is built upon. Thank you for your love, Lord, and we ask that you'd continue to lead us forward in it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we continue our worship, we're going to transition immediately into a time of sharing communion together. So I hope before the service you had a time to grab one of those little cups and wafers. We're going to continue to use those through the summer, and then we hope and intend in the fall that we'll be able to have more interactive and personal times together. Jesus says, "Whoever does God's will is my brother and sister and mother, his family." But Jesus reminds us too that God's will can be summarized in two brief statements. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets, Jesus says, hang on these two commandments. And so we come to the Lord's table this morning. We come with a small, really a tiny taste of the great meal and celebration that awaits us with God's people in heaven. But this gathering, coming near to the table, is not really about filling our stomachs. It's about being invited to draw near. God invites you to draw near. He has covered your sin and your shame through the blood of his Son, Jesus Christ. That's why we celebrate. Our shame is covered. Our sin is gone. We are all invited as God's family to draw near to the table, to do the things that families do together, to eat, to drink, to laugh, to cry, to live. Jesus tells the story of the great feast that we are looking forward to. In response to those many who are too busy, who are too important, who have other pursuits in their life, God sends out his servants. He says, go quickly into the streets and the alleys of the town and bring in the poor, the crippled, the blind, the lame. And as Jesus tells the story, the servants respond. They say, well, Lord, what you have ordered has been done, but there's still room. And so then the master tells his servants, go out into the roads and the country lanes and make them come in so that my house will be full. God is passionate with his love for his people. He wants his house to be filled with his people and filled with his love. He wants us to draw near to him. And so following Jesus' example, even as we love God and love others, we receive the love that Christ passed on to us. The Apostle Paul tells it this way. He says, I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. That on the night Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it. He said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, and he said, this cup is a new covenant in my blood. Drink from it. Do this in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. So take, eat, remember, and believe the body and the blood of Jesus given for the forgiveness of your sins, given to draw you in. Whoever does the will of our Father in heaven is my mother and sister and brother. You are welcome in the family of God at the table of the Lord. Let's come to him in prayer. Father, we thank you that using the simple and ordinary things of this world, bread and juice, that you are present in a real and powerful way. God, we can eat food on our own. We can eat more and have our stomachs be full. But when we gather here at the table, we thank you and praise you that you have covered our shame, that you have drawn us to be a part of your love and the love of your family through your Son, Jesus Christ. That even as we gather together to participate in this bread and juice, with the body of your people. Even as we are drawn in closer together, we celebrate, thank you, and praise you that you are here with us as well. Thank you, Father, for your love. Thank you for the beauty that is Jesus, the beauty that is the community that we are all drawn to be a part of. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's rise. Let's rise together and sing. As I was meditating on the words that Pastor Adrian shared, I wanted to share a thought experiment that I did once. It was, imagine that we did say, oh, there's flaws in God's Bible. And the word isn't the perfect word of God. There's some flaw in it. Can you imagine? I would say it was this part, and you would say it was that part, and we would be arguing forever about who was right and who was wrong. And wow, it would be an endless circular discussion of criticizing one another and criticizing God's word. But I just love that if we admit we're all broken, trying to find the holes in God's word is a useless exercise. We're completely beyond being able to try to decipher God's will. And it's that humility that's summarized so briefly in that word. You know, Jesus is the word. We sang that in the last song. We're standing on the word of God. That's Jesus. And word in Greek means logos. I love all these Greek words we heard. Logos. We're standing on the logic. And logic itself admits its own flawedness. And I think that's so beautiful. Let's sing about that beauty of God.
Wonderful, so wonderful is your unfailing love. The cross has spoken mercy over me. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no heart could fully know. How glorious, how beautiful.
Beautiful one, I adore.
We receive God's beauty and his love and also his blessing as you go. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, the power and presence of his Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you all. And all God's people say, amen. We're going to sing once more about his love. And all the people said amen. Amen means so be it. It's an emphatic exclamation point. So let's end our service that way together.
Enjoy some coffee together with us. And if you're on Zoom, fellowship with one another there in the breakout rooms. And God bless you all this week.
And youth in the gym.
And youth, yes. By
including really youth at heart.